survey they did several years ago that got us into this configuration. They are now trying to do an intersect survey to try to, I think, personally mitigate the mistake that they've done. So,
thank you, Ed.
Anyhow, that's the story. Thank you.
The new light rail cars, I found them pretty uncomfortable, but I can see that they're designed for volume and standing volume. But yeah, so make your comments. One more announcement? Okay. Well, let's get started then. We have two wonderful speakers tonight. I'll introduce Michael Barnes first, and we will then start with Ozzie Rohm. Michael Barnes attended grad school in economics at UC Berkeley and has taught there. He was the UC Berkeley science editor for 11 years and is also familiar with climate change, which might have something to do with some of these housing issues. And he has served on the Albany City Council since 2012. And while Albany is a tiny fraction of the size of San Francisco, it is very similar in terms of population density and ethnic makeup. He's been following SB 50 and the CASA programs, neither of which, he says, will meet their stated goals.
Dr. White needs their own stated goals.
our first speaker then is Ozzie Rohm. We welcome her back from a year ago, a three-decade resident of San Francisco, community organizer, neighborhood activist. She's a passionate advocate for fair planning and public inclusion in neighborhood and citywide land use issues. Like many other community advocates, Ozzie saw SB 50 as an attempt to wrest local planning control from our neighborhoods and the city. Her background includes software development and applications in biotech and e-commerce, and she's worked for a variety of tech firms, including HP, Applied Biosystems, and Genentech. So, welcome, Ozzie.
Thank you.
Do I go first?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Well, first of all, thank you so much to the Ashbury Neighborhood Council and Tess, in particular for inviting me to go through this legislation. And thanks to Bruce for accepting my revisions and putting up with it. And, you know, like,
Louder. Okay. I'll be like, I always thought I was born with a bottle. This is my first time that somebody's asking me to speak louder.
I agree.
Wow. Okay. So I'm going to have to move here a little bit so I could, go through this presentation simultaneously.
Do you want me to move the slides for you, Ozzie?
No, that's okay. I could do it from my from here. It's better because then I know, that'll. So, before we get into the Michaels here, so allow me to get back to my, who's my?
What, which one do you want?
Oh, no, this is CASA.
No, just look
here. You're right there.
All right, hold
it.
Hold it.
I have to synchronize.
Hold.
Are you definitely taking this?
Yes.
So it'll be on the web?
Eventually.
Thank you.
We plan, yes, we are recording this, at least the presenters. I'm not sure about the question period. And by the way, Ozzie, would you like questions during your presentation?
Let's finish the presentation because then, I never know if I could finish it within the allotted time.
Okay.
So,
is that better?
So, yes. Thank you so much. So before I go through this presentation, folks, let me give you the caveat that there are lots of holes and placeholders in this legislation as of today. So this is my best attempt to decipher what the intent is, who's going to be impacted, and what are the details. Who's going to qualify for this and what the details are. But, just qualifying this, that there are lots of placeholders and things that are actually going to make a difference in terms of what community is going to be impacted the most are TBD. So, same bill, different revisions. So this is very much similar to SB 827. It does have a few new features, such as extending the coverage to a new geography, job-rich areas. But for the most part, it is very much similar to what we had last year. So it targets transit-rich areas and I will get into what transit rich areas means for SB50. It extends it to job rich areas. It requires affordable housing, but this is nothing new because some of you may recall that last year, as one of the last revisions that Wiener gave us was, well, the cities could use inclusionary housing if they have to. It does offer tenant protection this time, and it does require fair wages, which means the use of union labor. Now, this is a very important slide. To qualify for SB 50, you have to fit into one of these, or you have to meet these requirements. So you have to live, you have to provide the area, the site has to be either transit rich or job rich. Transit rich areas, some of you who followed 827 last year probably already know. But they see transit rich areas, they're talking about areas that are within either half a mile of rail, BART, cable cars, ferry, or quarter mile of a frequently serviced bus. Job rich areas are, this is a generality, are affluent areas that are close to job centers and good schools. The second thing that you have to qualify for is offering a number of the units within the project to affordable housing. But as you can see, this number is still to be defined. In other words, not every project has to give. So this is the most important factor that is still vague and to be defined. Because if Wiener sets the threshold to say 10 units, in other words, if he requires projects with 10 units to give, then that means the folks that want to build only 9 units, if they just, you know, walk, you know, they don't have to give to affordable housing. He also has another provision that if your town comes with inclusionary laws, you could use your local inclusionary law if the percentage is higher than what the state density bonus law is. Now, one thing you have to remember, one of the biggest differences between most towns' inclusionary and the state density bonus is that the state density bonus law requires you to build those affordable homes on site. Now, for us in the city of San Francisco, that is not necessarily the requirement. Developers could build it on site, or they could just build it somewhere, you know, wherever they want, or they could easily fee out. So that's the biggest decision. Two other things, the site doesn't let you build, take advantage of this program if there have been tenants there, and the look back is 7 years. What do I mean by look back? That means if tenants have lived on the site within the 7 years prior to the applicant arriving with permit applications, it's off limit. You can't apply for this permit. Same concept for Ellis Acting. You cannot apply for this program if you Ellis Acted anyone in the 15 years prior to you coming in with your application.
So one tenant negates a whole building?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Within the 7 years. 7 year or 15 year. Okay, so this is what you get. If you qualify for what I showed you in the previous slide, then here are the bonuses. So all rail-rich, bus-rich, and job-rich areas will receive unlimited number of units. So there goes RH1, RH2, RH3. So that is the biggest giveaway that this legislation provides. So I want you to think of it in terms of gone are any zoning district that you currently have. Then obviously the second bullet doesn't apply to San Francisco because thanks to our, you know, city planning or, you know, I don't know which department was it that we decided we don't need to have any parking requirements. Then there is the 3 incentives. So you can get up to 3 incentives and concessions from the state density bonus law. But again, you have to give to the state density bonus, you have to give affordable housing to get up to 3 concessions and incentives. And since we don't know how much you have to give to get them, so this is a very gray area. But all I can tell you is that if you qualify for the state density bonus law. You will get up to 3 incentives and concessions, and that means that you would get waivers for yard setback, height, design guidelines, you name it. So basically the idea is you give a little, you take a lot. So that's why the title of this presentation is what you said. So what about the added height, you guys? Remember last year the whole rage was about, you know, everything's going to be like, you know, 10 stories. So this year it's not going to be 10 stories, it's going to be only 8 stories. So that's a good news. But again, it's the added height is going to be only vis-a-vis areas that are going to be near the rail, ferry, cable cars, or, you know, Muni Metro, that is. And you have to give a certain percentage. Again, you know, like, note that the percentage is left blank. So we don't know how much they're going to come in. If they come in with 1%, we know. But again, the use of the state density bonus is going to add to this height. So right now, he is offering anywhere from 45 feet to 55 feet, depending on the proximity to rail, Muni Metro, cable car, et cetera. But then you could actually up the ante if you use the state density bonus. And meaning, if you give a little to affordable housing. So here's a map of San Francisco and its various rail options. So as you can see, this is the most important visual for you to see who's going to be impacted. Because the map actually shows the neighborhoods, folks. So as you see, the northern neighborhoods are kind of spared, except with North Beach, Russian Hill, because they are near cable cars. But then you have, so who do you think is going to be impacted the most? I'll tell you, it's Bayview, Hunters Point, it's Viz Valley. Believe it or not, parts of Twin Peaks, West Side, you know, is going to be impacted. Outer Sunset, you know, so this is basically the impact of areas that are going to be hit with added height. But again, they have to give to the affordable housing. So you may ask, what about the areas near the bus? Well, that's 96% of San Francisco. So just like last year, we are hit by 96% of the city, be it through added height, added density, or both. So now, back to that slide. So Hoover's bears the brunt of this. In this crowd, I'm sure it's no surprise that it's going to be more underprivileged neighborhoods, working class neighborhoods that are not as affluent and she as some of our other neighborhoods. And unlike what our detractors keep saying about, you know, the single family homes, oh my God, those evil single family homeowners. As you can see, the highest percentage of single family homes in the city of San Francisco happens to be in Excelsior. And the Excelsior income level, folks, is like on the median, you know, I think it's like, if I'm not mistaken, that's what I was looking, you know, it was, and these are the figures that the city of San Francisco Planning Department publishes. I think it was like, you know, hovering around under 60,000. So, at college education level in the teens. So, we're talking about a bill that is disproportionately affecting working class and poor neighborhoods. And, you know, when the developer can go and hit Bayview and buy a lot for $900,000, I assure you, he's not going to come after more affluent neighborhoods. And of course, you know, Bayview is rail rich, so they're going to get added height and other bonuses. But basically, these are the areas that are going to be hit hardest. And even according to the planning department, their figures, you know, way back in 2007, which is, you know, like 12 years ago, I'm sure now it's even worse. For every 100 market rate condo that gets built, you need 25 lower income households you know, that are going to be taking care of the consumption of these 100 unit condo owners. So where are these people going to move to? So what about tenant protection? So this is one big difference that this year Scott Huner, you know, gave us the gift that keeps on giving. This year he gave us this one different protection for tenants. So the tenant-occupied and Ellis-active properties are off-limits. But if we don't know where these properties are, how can we protect them? So cities cannot enforce this. This is, you know, this provision sounds really good, altruistic, but how can we enforce it if we don't know where the tenant occupied properties are? Now, in the entire state of California, which I believe we have 412 cities, something around that, we have only 7 cities that have tenant rental registries. Berkeley is one, East Palo Alto is another one, Santa Monica, but then, guess what? San Francisco isn't one of them. So bottom line, without a rental registry, this is not going to be handy. So here's my little pitch. Those of you who are passionate about doing something, join me in helping the city to put together a rental registry. We are working on it with Supervisor Fuel. So some people have brought up the impact on job rich areas. Okay, so that's another new thing that Scott has thrown this year. And I'm coming back saying, we still don't know the impact. It all depends on those blank number of units, blank percentage. It could impact affluent suburban neighborhoods, or it may not. It's not a simple equation. When you're talking about affordable housing, it all depends where it is. It all depends, you know, like if affluent neighborhoods it's going to be feasible for them to have on-site affordable housing. So there are a lot of unanswered questions here. So I'm not sure what the impact is. There might be or there may not be. It all depends. So general rule of thumb is that affordable housing and affluent neighborhoods don't mix well. So, and in order to back my statement, case in point is our HomeSF, our own version of density bonus that came to light in 2016. Supervisor Tang introduced it, and basically it was 2 extra floors in exchange for 30% affordable housing on site. Now they just amended it to 25% giving to affordable housing in exchange for 1 floor. Now, 2 years later to date, folks, there has not been even one project built using this. And the only project that has been approved by the planning department using this HomeSF ordinance is 2601 Van Ness Avenue. That's on Van Ness, that's the only one. So I'm just showing you the shop-rich area of Union Street because as there were talks about this particular ordinance one day, I was walking on Union Street and I couldn't help but noticing all these one-story shops and thinking, oh my God, they are going to be impacted. Well, I was wrong because the economy of Union Street, affordable housing on site, it just doesn't work. And it hasn't, no project from that part of town has come to the planning department. And, you know, basically because also this particular ordinance only applied to one-story commercial buildings. That's why I picked Union Street. So it wasn't there just, you know, any outward. So is inclusionary housing mandatory per SB 50? That's the biggest question. Well, not really. It's not. Because again, in the beginning of the talk I told you, it all depends on that magic number. If Scott comes up with anything above 7 units they have to give to affordable housing, then you can come with 6 units and get out of jail free card. You don't have to. Now, some might say, well, wait a minute, what's the point? Because you're not going to get added height, you're not going to get added bells and whistles, you know, no setback. Well, I'm telling you folks, once you, they get unlimited number of units, that is basically the magic word. Unlimited number of units. That's what is going to be the goals. And to illustrate, you know, my point, I'm giving you an example. So suppose Scott comes out with the threshold at 5 units. So anyone that is making 5 units, they will have to give to affordable housing. So Mr. Developer comes with 4 units, and he doesn't have to give. But he will have the right to build that 4 units on an RH1 lot. Now, one advantage of an RH1 lot is that unlike other residential zoning, you could build up to 75% of the lot. Now, 75% of the lot, and you go the same height as we have 40 feet, that will give you 4 small apartments. And you can't DR, you can't do conditional use authorization, you can't do anything. So by the virtue of upzoning from 1 unit to 4 units, you would actually be able to take advantage of this bill without having to give to affordable housing. I personally think the whole intent of this bill is basically deregulating our zoning. So here's a little illustration of what it could look like. You don't need to go up. So in other words, height, added height and whatnot, you know. Within a great deal of houses in the city are not built to take advantage of that full 40-foot height, believe it or not. They're not. So within the planning code regulations, without even getting any bonuses, they can still take advantage of the deregulation of the zoning districts and build as many units as it fits within their lot, especially if it's an RH1, because you could build up to 75% of the lot. So what is that? So this bill is going to be ushering in new as-of-right era. There goes our discretionary review. There goes our conditional use authorizations, design review, all of that, bye-bye. And another possibility is that it might even nullify our demolition law scopes. It's too complex for me in the time frame to describe the situation and why it is, but then Scott Mayer himself has said that he's going to honor the local demolition laws, but with a little caveat, as long as it doesn't interfere with Housing Accountability Act. Well, Housing Accountability Act is basically the tool that the YIMBY legal faction is using to force building whatever they want to build. So they're basically coming out and saying that you have to build, because if you don't build, you are in contempt of the Housing Accountability Act. So that's what's in the store for us. So does San Francisco need more upzoning? Well, my answer is no, because the numbers tell the story. As of the third quarter, we've had 43,000 units that were entitled to be built. So these developers could start building tomorrow. And 28,000 of them, you know, were in 8 master plans, in other words, 8 large sites. Another thing is, you have to keep in mind the new data that has come out, thanks to this PhD student that did a study on the upzoning changes in Chicago, and he's come out saying, well, first of all, the land prices went up. Second of all, it didn't give us enough supply to actually make it cheaper. So this whole myth of supply, you build, so the prices are going to come down, it's an absolute myth. This is not like apples and oranges. So upzoning basically in dense urban areas make matters worse. So bottom line is Gloria Steinem's famous saying that San Francisco needs more upzoning than fishing with a bicycle. So now let's talk about the local. So what about the local control? Local control is great, folks. Without local control, we couldn't have put a brake some of these awful projects that keep coming to the planning commission. Without local controls, the neighborhood's voice would have been silent. A great example is what happened last Thursday at the Mission High when a whole bunch of people from the Mission neighborhood came to object to the monster of the Mission. And if we didn't have local control, projects like the monster of the Mission would have been built years ago. Without local control, we would not be able to hold on to our demolition laws. So local control is great because it does protect vulnerable communities. And it has the ability to better manage shared resources like water, you know, and all the other good things. You know, we already know that. I'm preaching to the choir about local control. Now, the big question is, what do you do with cities that, you know, in affluent job-rich areas that have spent all this time building office space after office space without paying their fair share in building homes for these office space? So, I mean, that is a dilemma. So what do you do with cities that have built office parks, office spaces, taking advantage of the taxes that these office spaces and corporations bring to that city, but then no housing? So that is basically the dilemma with this situation. And here's actually Paul Weber's answer that I stole from him. So Paul Weber, some of you know him, you know, I've worked with him, but he basically has a real good idea. Why not pair housing with jobs? And Calvin would say, well, that's not his idea. He stole the idea from me, from Prop. Same with Dennis. You guys are working on Prop M, which is basically the precursor to this type of thinking. You know, you can't just keep building office space, you know, unlimited. You know, that is gonna, you know, an imbalance between office space and housing is gonna come and bite us, you know, like it has today. So the reality is that cities in the Bay Area have been uneven in terms of response to housing needs. And the lion's share of the housing has been borne by urban areas like San Francisco, Oakland, San Jose. And suburban areas have just kept on building office space after office space. So we need to come up with, push for a balance, housing and job balance. The problem is not only the housing job balance, the problem is housing job fit, which tells you how many low income housing are available for low wage jobs. So this situation is actually worse and is getting worse because of lack of attention that some of the suburban areas have paid to this issue. So this is, you know, the graph and charts that, you know, speaks to my point. In the period between 1980 to 2015, the San Mateo County has created over three jobs for every one unit of housing, okay? And at the same time, San Francisco has created 1.73 jobs for every one unit of housing. So clearly, we have this imbalance. Now, mind you, San Mateo County has 744 square miles, and we have only 49 square miles. So for us to create housing, it's far harder. It involves demolitions. We've already been, you know, developed. Nevertheless, we kept on doing it. How did we do that? Well, we upsold the eastern neighborhoods. So the problem is that we have been basically addressing the issue for the market rate homes. We've been totally late on the affordable housing, but market rate homes, we have done what we, you know, I mean, more than our fair share. And the next slide shows you this. So the city of San Francisco has permitted, and this is a 2017 data, 6,731 units in 2017, and San Mateo County, with all its might, just permitted 1,575 units, okay? Here's another data. New jobs versus new housing. So between 2010 and 2016, San Mateo County created 79,000 jobs and only 3,800 new homes. This is a ratio of 16 to 1. slide is even more frightening. So this is the worker commute, folks. 46,000 people schlep every day from Alameda County to come to San Mateo County to work. Now you tell me, how on earth would Scott Wiener, Risky 50, going to solve this situation if San Francisco is going to be upzoning those neighborhoods to build even more housing? Because how is the Alameda worker who has to come to San Mateo County to work going to be housed somewhere in between? I mean, definitely not in San Francisco, because those homes are going to be still too expensive to house them. So basically, you know, what I'm trying to demonstrate to you is that we do have a problem with trying to level the playing field, and as long as we can't have some sort of a measure to get other cities to actually pay their fair share, we're always going to be faced with this inequality. So this is another startling thing. This is about renters. So the red areas, folks, are the ones that the ratio of affordable rental, you know, to the available ones is like 2 to 4. From this, I don't know if you can see or not, but San Francisco, East Palo Alto, Oakland, those are still some of the available rental units, available low rent units where people can actually use them.
I don't understand that. You need 4 people needed and 2 people can
so
get it.
This is like low wage jobs to affordable low rent units. So the people who are, this is the ratio, so the red ones are the ones that are greater than 4. So there are 4 low rent jobs for every 1 low rent unit in these red areas. Now, in the yellow areas, it's 2. In the green areas, it's 1 to 2. So the more yellow and green you get, the more affordable becomes for renters. And the only reason that we do have this is because we have rent control. So how does SB 50 address these disparities? It doesn't. So urban areas will continue to be the target of developers. Why? Because we're transit rich. And we have cheaper land, as I demonstrated to you guys. We do have areas such as Bayview, Hunters Point, Excelsior, that our land is cheaper than other areas, more affluent suburban areas, Silicon Valley, peninsula areas, and land is far more expensive. So it is more advantageous for the developers to take advantage of these lands as opposed to go now. So and my question is, why add a new jobbridge geography when you could just solve the imbalance by pairing housing with job creation? Now, somebody else asked this question. This is not my question, but this is a very valid point. If you're trying to level the playing field, if you're trying to actually get people to build homes, why not use their RENA performance? Remember what RENA is, the regional housing need allocation. So our excellent senator uses RENA to push what? The hallmark of his career, SB 35. SB 35 is RENA based. But when it comes to this, he's not using RENA. He's just resorting to transit-rich areas, folks. Why is that? Because transit-rich areas are more more juicy, for lack of a better word, more juicy for developers. So the bottom line, I don't think SB 50 is going to solve our problems. It's not going to solve our housing problems, for sure. And it's going to strip San Francisco of local controls. It's going to decimate the working class and underprivileged neighborhoods. And it's basically same bill, different lipstick, as I said at the beginning of this presentation. And if you ask me, what to do, how to face the music, how to oppose it, I'm just saying the things that we have to oppose is basically hands off adverse communities. If it's a matter of all nine Bay Area counties having to pay their fair share, look at what counties have not produced homes while they kept on producing office space, and try to get them to do that. Above all, we need affordable housing, and this is not going to address them. So that's
the question.
Should we answer questions or should we let Michael talk? No, I have no idea.
Why don't we take about four questions and then hear from our second speaker?
This is really
can people speak as loud as possible? Thank you.
Okay, so the question is, what's the difference between what? Low-income housing and affordable housing?
Affordable, yeah. What can I afford?
Okay, so low-income housing, it is a succinct definition. It says if you are within this income range, you are in this county, in this city, you are considered low income. Okay, but it depends on where you are. But affordable housing is a broader, it's a broader notion. Affordable housing could be if you're providing below market rate housing, that is in general called affordable housing.
It's not defined, so a lot of things are not defined.
Yes, Bruce.
So with regards to transit, Rich, so is that defined by the intervals?
Yes.
Between, so
exactly.
So could MTA then control how things are built?
Yes. Same, it's basically the same build. Yes. MTA could, if you live in a town that doesn't want to deal with this, well, just call up your local MTA and tell them to run the buses and you're 5 minutes late.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is transit rich only public transit or does it include commuter shuttles?
He hasn't defined that. He only talks about, that's another one. He hasn't gotten to that level of granularity. So what I'm saying is there are opportunities in this city, be it the West homes are not going to, you know, lower their price. We need to force the government to spend the money to build affordable housing.
Certainly, here in District 5, there aren't too many places that you could build an 8- or 10-story building without demolishing existing sound housing. And that's an issue that Supervisor Peskin has legislation trying to address that. But as Ozzie pointed out, there's some gaps in this bill, which it has to be finalized by the end of the month, I believe.
No, they changed it. It's going to go to June.
Oh, they okay. They have more time to finalize it then.
Right.
But that means that the main places that can be targeted are commercial districts that have one-story buildings and gas stations.
Gas stations, exactly.
So, but let's take a couple more. I think here and then over there.
Yes.
Two things. I wanted to make sure everybody was aware they're trying to build a 9-story building on Fulton at Broadway.
Yeah.
And they want to take down a 2-story warehouse that's there that's not a garage. But this is a block, a historic neighborhood of all 2-story Victorians. And they're going to build the entire lot line, 100 feet by 100 feet, the entire lot line, 9 stories, casting shadows a block away in every direction. So, of course, we're opposed to that, and I want everybody to be aware of that. And then all this talk about we need 300,000 units of housing in San Francisco, nobody's talking about infrastructure. Our freeways are already way too bad. The transportation, the buses, the community park, everything. Nobody's talking about where's the billions of dollars to improve the infrastructure, schools, fire, police. Nobody's even talking about this. They want to bring thousands, hundreds of thousands of people here. We can't handle the people that are already here. Our systems are lacking. And this is irresponsible to talk about any more development without talking about infrastructure first.
No, I agree. But that's why we need you, the young gentleman, you know, that hopes to raise his family. We need you to actually put the pressure on the city to provide the infrastructure. I think it's not a zero-sum game that you would say, oh, I'm only for the housing. We need to actually champion that as well.
The laws are pushing for both. It shouldn't take us 17 years to clean a restaurant off here. And 9 stories sounds great.
Okay. Last question over there, and then we're going to have the second speaker and more questions.
So regarding infrastructure, you guys probably noticed last week the Richmond Bridge had cement falling.
Yes.
Traffic backed up across the city into the Broadway tunnel, so it's going to be a bigger issue. And that's maybe, you know, 63%, I think you said. People are coming from Alameda, crossing over.
Yeah.
Do you know any of the regional planning aspects of this? ABAG?
Weren't
they supposed to be working on this the last
I didn't
year?
Even tell you.
Is that what they wanted? Because it seems like it is.
That's what they want. I mean, 50% of the workforce in San Mateo County make less than $50,000.
There you go.
Okay, this is a perfect segue into the next presentation, which will include some of the more regional aspects. I reintroduced Michael Barnes from Albany, but we will also be addressing some of SB 50 and the CASA plan.
Check it out. It's there. Okay, so I'm here to talk about CASA. I'm sorry, I'm losing my voice, so I'll talk as loudly as possible. I'm going to try to tell you a little bit straight up about what CASA is, but you can just read that on our website. So I'm going to give you my perspective on it, too, based on my experience. So I just want to say, I'm only speaking for myself, not for the Albany City Council. That's the disclaimer we also have to make. All right, why should you care what I have to say? My background's pretty diverse. I was way back in the 80s a city government economic analyst. I did economics, both of the neoclassical variety and the Marxist variety. I wasn't really very happy with either until I worked around a state legislature, and then I was like turning over a rock and you go, oh, that's how the world really works. So within the 90s, I taught economics at Berkeley, but I've more and more drifted into being interested in science. And I joked I moved from being interested in pseudoscience to real science. So the last 11 or 12 years of my life, I was a science editor at UC Berkeley College of Chemistry, which is the best college of chemistry on the planet, and it was great to rub elbows with all these top-notch scientists. And I think their kind of clear-headedness and analytical ability rubbed off on me, I hope. So, you know, I've done policy, and then I've been on my local school board for 4 years and 6 years into being on my local city council. A lot of the issues that, you know, your take of San Franciscans on these issues is interesting. It's very different than my little town, but let me get into that. First of all, if you're looking to find money to do development in cities, and you're like the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, who has some jurisdiction over the whole nine-county area, there's about 100 little local governments in this map. And you can just kind of think about, well, if I could just grab some parcel tax money or sales tax money, progressive sources of funding, and do something with that. So what I want to point out is there's 7.8 million people in the nine-county area. Only 30% of them live in the three big cities. Granted, some of the other places like San Mateo have high population densities as well. But it's kind of a big world out there. And my concern is really with what I call an emerging model of progressive regionalism, that money, you know, there's an old joke about foreign aid is when poor people in a rich country give to rich people in a poor country. But something like that is happening in the area. And I want to dip it in the butt. This is my little town, 1 square mile. San Francisco is generally considered to be 49 square miles. So you're about 50 times bigger.
46.7 square
miles. Yeah, hang on. According to the American Census Bureau, it is. Well, yeah, it's 47. But anyway, so this is our populated area is 1 square mile. We have 2 commercial corridors, Solano Avenue, San Pablo Avenue. We're doing an affordable housing development here. This is a very built-out city, so we're working on ADUs, accessory dwelling units. That's our low-hanging fruit. And me, I would love to see, now, you can't really tell us, but right up here is where El Cerrito Plaza is and the El Cerrito BART station. There's now a transit-oriented development there, which I think is quite ugly. But, and I would be very happy if we could get more height and more density here, because along in here, people can just walk to BART. So I just want to give you a brief comparison of Albany is really very much a microcosm of San Francisco. Similar population density, about 18 to 20,000 people per square mile. We're a little younger. That's because we have a pretty good school district. We're a little bit wider, but both of us are minority-majority cities, many now in California. We have a little bit more white folks and more mixed folks, which I'm assuming is all the populations I see in town, like my son, who is now 27, he's not really getting old. Papa, he's, I mean, doesn't Papa, people know what that word means? Papa is a Hawaiian slang word, means Papa Howley, he's half white, half Asian. But the mixed race kids refer to themselves now as being Papa. My son's half Chinese. So anyway, so also, you know, pretty dense cities. We have a little higher degree of education, and that's because university housing is evolving. We have a lot of families from overseas who get their kids into our school district and then figure out how to stay there. We are about half renter, half homeowners. San Francisco is a little more heavily weighted towards renters. And to address this gentleman's points, I appreciate affordable housing because when I was a graduate student at Berkeley, I moved into the University Village in 1995. I had a little two-bedroom apartment with my son. It was $600 a month. And so what you have in this town, and what we are really trying to preserve, is kind of this funky, charming, but traditionally middle-class town where you could be a graduate student and, you know, go to school, have a couple of kids, get unplugged into the school district, and eventually end up staying there for 30 or 40 years and buying a house. Although I didn't buy my house till I was 44. I bought my first new car at 39. still drive it, it's super nice, 23 years old. But anyway, so let's get, so anyway, some similarities, some differences with San Francisco. Now, I'm sorry, I'm now going to put on my cranky technocrat hat. I'm joking, the city council, I'm a cranky technocrat, every city council needs one. I just like the use of the word crisis because it makes everyone suddenly shut off their brains. Remember George W. Bush's social security crisis? Yeah, crisis, and the solution was going to be privatizing the social security system. That, fortunately, that idea ended thanks to partially thanks to Nancy Pelosi in 2008, the stock market crisis. We currently have Donald Trump's immigration crisis. I'll let you judge that one for yourself. My point is, we do have a serious housing shortage, but the housing shortage is a symbol of an underlying problem, and that's a lack of rational regional planning. We've had a lack of that planning, and it manifests itself in the housing crisis. We've also, and like I always like to say, growth is not an act of God. Growth is not an act of God. Someone could have been anticipating patterns of development, like the gentleman over here said. Something happened, and it wasn't anticipated. Also, we've had years of deinstitutionalizing mental patients. We have horrible problems with opiate abuse and very methamphetamine abuse. But all these, and then growing income quality. I was writing papers about growing income quality in college in the 1980s. It's been 30 years that problem. So all of these issues come to focus with housing. But the housing shortage is multifactorial. There's lots of things that lead to the housing crisis. Yet what I hear and what bothers me as someone who used to teach economics at Berkeley is all we talk about is shifting out the housing supply curve. So it's the Econ 101 question is that, is it sufficient to shift out the housing supply curve if you want to control equilibrium quantities and prices? And the answer is no, because in order for that to be the case, you have to make the implicit assumption that demand is not shifting. But we all know the dot-com boom, but with the tech boom, demand is going through the roof. So if you have supply and demand and they're both moving out, you can increase supply of lots which aren't necessarily going to reduce prices. It's indeterminate. And this is the kind of question that we have in the second week midterm. So there needs to be attention paid to both the demand side and the supply side. And how do you, and it's a good question, how do you cope with the incredible amount of increasing demand we have? And one of the premier economic geographers in the country, Richard Walker, wrote this book, I talked to him a couple of weeks ago, called Pictures of a Gone City, Tech and the Dark Side of Prosperity. And he really goes into this. So I got my copy for $20.
What is the title again? Yeah.
Oh, here. Let me just hand it down. All right, so enough intro. Okay, CASA. CASA, it's not quite an acronym. CASA is Community Housing Bay Area. It's the brainchild of the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. I am not a fan of the Metropolitan. So MTC started out as just the Transportation Housing Commission. You need a commission like that to pass through federal and state grants for transportation purposes. MTC also gets to collect all the bridge tolls on every bridge in the Bay Area. That's seven, except the Golden Gate Bridge. And what do they over 60, it will come to me. So it basically is governed very loosely by people appointed from local government. For example, the elected official who's the head of MTC on paper is Jake McKenzie, who's on City Council in Roanoke Park. And the ED of who is retiring of MTC is appointed by the board. And CASA is basically his brain. Steve Hemminger. I don't want to say a lot about it because he's gone in a few months, he's retired. So in any case, it's loosely controlled. There's many of these nine County Bay Area organizations. They're loosely controlled by boards made up of typically of representative officials of some kind, city councils, counties. But in MTC's case, it's very loosely controlled.
Appointed
or elected,
that's what she's asking.
Appointed.
They're appointed.
I don't know. No, having been around,
MTC is basically elected, or they're all elected officials, but they're appointed by either the county or the city that they're from. It's a formula on where. So the mayor of San Jose, Sam Liccardo, sits on it, okay? And then you've got, you know, Scott McKenzie from Roanoke Park sits on it. And then that's how it's constituted. And then they elect among themselves who's going to be the chairman and things like that.
All right, now, the other thing is I've been to many dinners and events with the staff of MTC. They're great people. I don't want to impugn the quality of people who work at MTC, but sometimes with these big bureaucracies, the whole is less than the sum of parts. So that's what we're dealing with with MTC. Okay, CASA. Let's keep going. CASA has 10 elements. I'm going to list them pretty fast. The first thing to remember about them is they're just basically suggestions. They don't have any. They're suggestions. They don't have any force until a legislator like Scott Wiener formulates them as a piece of legislation, which may or may not be passed. Like CASA element 5 is basically SB 50. And there's some other examples of that. The CASA committee was handpicked pretty much by Steve Hemminger from the usual suspects, but it's often called, you know, the urban growth machine. It's developers, including affordable housing developers, leaders of building and trade unions, big city mayors, some corporations, foundations, urban planning groups, some county and other officials, but no local government officials from East Bay. That's because we kind of put a party group for speech so we know how things work on the ground, blah, blah, blah. We just messed with that, you know. All right, so, except for elements 9 and 10, they're new, and I think they're very popular. I'm going to try to whiz through this. It's sort of, the good stuff comes up front, the dangerous stuff comes in the back, so I want to go through this pretty quickly. The first three CASA elements are renter protections. Just cause eviction, emergency rent cap, which is just basically rent control, a fairly weak form of rent control. And then element 3 is more interesting. Emergency rent assistance. The advocates are already complaining these laws. These have been watered down since they were first discussed. For example, just cause eviction doesn't apply to anyone in their first year of tenancy. so the landlord said he just called it eviction. Based on my experience, we discussed rent control and rent review in Albany for 2 years. And so we'll just see. Once this gets up to the meat grinder in Sacramento, we'll see if this survives at all. Emergency rent cap, it's very high. It's 5% plus CPI. For big corporate landlords, that's not a problem. They're big enough to be able to smooth it, their cash flow. So sometimes it's a problem for mom and pops because they have, you know, a porch collapse and the roof needs to get fixed and they need to raise the rent. Element number three is also true on the renter side. Renters also have cash flow problems. And sometimes it helps they have access to short-term loans, to sort of bridging loans. So they don't, it's easier to keep people in housing than it is to get them back into housing. And element three, you know, deals with that issue. You know, I like element three, but I work with a lot of chemical engineers and they're all saying, yes, but can you scale that process up? And it would be, it's hard to imagine that you're going to scale that up to 7.8 million people. And several people have made that concern. Again, we'll see what comes out of the meat grinder in Sacramento. Element four, although that's what we're working on in Albany, ADUs, I think it's very constrained. There's an ADU going in next door. I have a contractor on the other side of me. I'm trying to get plumbing in my studio so I can utilize it. Problem number one of ADUs is getting the attention of the contractor. Accessory dwelling.
What's an ADU?
Accessory dwelling.
Accessory
dwelling.
In-law.
In-law. Brand flats.
All right. Thank you.
Sorry, there's a lot of acronyms in this world, like the military. So just stop me if you're acronyms. It'll make sense. ADUs are a little low-hanging fruit for us, but, and there's lots of people working on streamlining. Mike Kowski is a senator in the East State. He's very big on streamlining, so people can build ADUs faster. Wise and cruising, but someone's backyard, and tear down the shed that's in the way. And also, they have 129 acres, a lot of that's parking lots, little car stations. And when AD 2923 was being proposed, three of the four BART commissioners who would be, whose areas, regions would be affected by this, begged the legislature not to do it. Said, we want to focus on a ridership, we don't want to be housing developers, so please don't do this. The legislature did it. I am only really aware of one good example of the problems that arise, and that is North Berkeley BART, which has now about 850 parking. People, it has quite a cash flow basis. People funnel in from, you know, several miles away to park there and then to park.
Sorry, where's that?
North Berkeley Park. It's the one just south of me. So now they're thinking about building a lot of housing on that BART station. And the question is, what's going to happen to the people, the riders who are already parking there and then taking the BART into San Francisco? If you get rid of too many of those parking spaces, they won't have anywhere to park. They'll try to park in the neighborhoods. The neighborhoods eventually get tired and they'll try to lobby for permit parking. And then maybe those people who are driving BART now, taking BART now, are just going to drive in the city instead. So, you know, there's a balancing act here. And you have to, I think you have to be careful how you get rid of parking in public transportation. Now, one other thing I want to point out here, because the idea is we're unlocking land for affordable housing. Affordable housing isn't really affordable in the sense that it's cheaper than building any other kind of housing. When you build a building, it costs a certain amount of money, whether it's market rate or affordable. Now, here's the analogy I want to make. When you buy a house, you can either make a big down payment on the house and have a small mortgage payment for 15 or 30 years, or you can make a small down payment and you can have a bigger mortgage. You know, but you can drive down the monthly cost if you front run. But either way, the house costs you the same amount. The same is true in the apartment building. Affordable housing developers get a lot of money up front in the form of grants. And they pay a lot of capital costs up front. That allows them to charge but much lower rents over the course of the lifetime forward. So how much do those, is the per cost subsidy, not the, to build the place, the per cost subsidy just to make it affordable? It runs $300,000 to $400,000 per unit. And I've heard this number many times from many different people. It seems like a lot. So if BART wants to build 100 affordable housing units at North Berkeley BART, it's got to find $30 or $40 million worth of grants. You know, there is money out there with various sources of trying to get more money available. One problem was the Republican tax bill because it lowered the tax rate on corporations so much they have much less incentive for them to invest in these programs. So, Jeff, I think we all need to be aware that there's a hard constraint out there, which is the amount of affordable housing we can build in the Bay Area is going to cost so many billions of dollars that we're going to run out of people who are going to give us money. Which, by the way, is one of the reasons we're talking about CASA. All right, so how are we going to do this? We're going to take it from local governments. That's how we're going to do it. We're from on a dead body. This is the cost of the chart about where we're going to try to find $1.5 billion. Remember, there's 100 local throughout the whole Bay Area. And this applies to San Francisco, too. You know, they'll be coming out for people in San Francisco. Interestingly, the yellow dots are the interesting ones. They require voter approval. That is, for example, there's a $48 a year parcel tax. This one doesn't affect local government so much, but general obligation bonds, you typically pay for those on the ad valorem side of your property tax bill. Sales taxes, you pay for those. These are typically very important source of local government revenue. My concern is that local governments have our own crisis coming, that's the pension crisis. We're going to need a lot of these kind of, the type of revenue sources we traditionally had, which are pretty regressive revenue sources, but that's what we've got. Parcel taxes, you know, general obligation bonds, sales taxes, and all of the stuff that we want to do. And the idea of CASA is that they're going to try to grab this money throughout the nine county area and direct it, you know, from the poor periphery of the nine county area into the major cities. And there's some issues with equity about doing that, and there's an issue about whether or not they're going to accomplish that because the city they're going to fight now. And they already are.
So what if the city's going to vote for? So that's another thing. I think one thing, you know, like maybe you could have illuminated, because I hear a lot of pushback from the cities in particular regarding the taxation. But CASA, as you said, is just a basic policy recommendation. So unless the cities vote for it.
That's right. Well, that's. I mean, actually, you know, actually, I went way over. I need to wrap this up. Yeah. But let's just move down here. This is the model. There's many of these nine county sort of quasi public appointed elected officials who get appointed by somebody. There's MTC, there's the San Francisco Bay Conservation and Development Commission, there's the Bay Area Air Quality Management District, and there's a new one which we voted for in 2016 in June, called the San Francisco Bay Regional Authority, which charges a $12 parcel tax on everybody's property tax bill throughout the nine county area, regardless of whether you're Google or Chicano farm worker living up near, you know, Cloverdale, the northern part of Sonoma County.
Is that for Bay cleanup?
I'm sorry?
Is that for the Bay cleanup?
Yeah, most of the money goes to the South Bay to restore the salt ponds in front of some of the wealthiest corporations in the world. And this is what I call regressive regionalism. You know, we need regional models for this stuff. This is a very bad model, I think. It's very regressive. It funnels money to the wealthiest part of the Bay Area. But were successful in doing it. And
what do you mean, just partial taxes? Or
well, that's a good point. Let me finish up with that. If we go down to this bullet point here, when this legislative session opened, it kind of opens for a few days ceremoniously, and then it closes, and then you introduce the new governor and all that stuff. But this time around, there's 198 new bills actually introduced in the first few days of this ceremonial open. One of them was ACA 1. Now, here's how it works under Prop 13. If you want to do a parcel tax or if you want to earmark a tax for a specific purpose, you need a supermajority of 2/3, 37%. The exception now is bonds for schools, which are only 55%. Well, what ACA 1 will do, it's a constitutional amendment that has to be approved by the legislature and then taken to the voters, but it will lower threshold for these taxes again. And this will include taxes for also the public enhancements, public funding of housing and many other things. So in other words, so what we're going to see, it's going to be a lot easier to pass these kind of regional partial taxes
if they get that.
If they get this through. So that's part of the plan with MTC.
That impacts Prop 13?
Well,
need to be overdone.
Well, the Howard Jarvis people are ballistic about it.
You have Prop 13, you can do more progressive taxation, right? It's because of Prop 13, if you're doing parcel taxes and job taxes instead of just progressive property tax.
Progressive property tax. Well, that's complicated. But what we can do and what's going to be on the ballot in 2020 is called, generically referred to as split roll.
Right.
Yeah.
We're going to be changing the laws on commercial property because they basically avoid it being reassessed. So I think that's going to be a big battle in 2020. Property taxes are complex. We can talk about it. Little local governments like ours spend a lot of time trying to figure out where you can charge people on property taxes. That's one of our main sources of revenue. So let me wrap up and then we'll do the questions. So CASA is coming, it needs legislative approval. I think the funding aspect of it is very onerous for local governments. I think it shifts a lot of money away from poor regions to cities to fund projects for big developers. And in fact, this is a quote I pulled off the internet. Jake McKenzie, who's the elected official who's the head of MTC, went back to his little Monarch Park City Council meeting and introduced the CASA plan. And he almost got run out of town on the rail. I mean, it was an R-rated meeting. The other rest of the council members were ballistic. And city council managers and lead meetings like that also are the city managers who are not elected, they're the appointed staff. They're also grown-ups in the room. And so Darren, by the way, I write back to Darren, great guy, an engineer by training. He summarized what CASA is all about. I think this is a very realistic appraisal. It's really planned by affordable developers in big cities. But they're thinking about how can we incentivize and have construction of housing in our cities? And how can we raise money that will flow into our cities and development projects? And it's pretty clear that's what they're doing. But there's an awful lot of equity issues involved with CASA. So we will see how it plays out.
Why does he say that it's a plan chiefly by off the affordable developers as opposed to the big developers and real estate investors and so on?
I think it's because he was talking at city council meeting, he informally, it's a pretty clean
analysis of CASA, and I didn't see that the affordable developers, of which there are some, are really the cause of this giant MTC plan.
Yeah, I think it was arbitrary that he put affordable in front of developers. He was just speaking to me. If he had to sit down and write this quote, he might have written it. This is a verbatim translation of what he said. There are certainly on the CASA committee has many affordable housing developers on it. For sure. I'm sorry, you had your hand up, this gentleman here.
Yeah,
Yeah, the, like the parcel tax and all, just look on your property tax because it's below the line. And that's where they stack all of the additional taxes. Your Prop 13, you know, just goes along at 2% a year increase in the mill rate, but it's below the line on your property tax is what you have to look at and see all of the additional charges that get put on there.
Right, so there's two in, but also...
And your general obligation bonds and all the other stuff, right. It's voted on.
So your property tax bill is split into two pieces. There's parcel taxes, which are fixed taxes that everybody pays regardless of how much their house costs.
On your assessed
value. Is that senior
citizens? No.
The law.
It depends. No, it's not based on your assessed value. It's just...
Based on how many parcels you have.
Right. Typically...
Bank of America building 16 parcels.
Right. And most homeowners have one parcel, and like in Albany, we all pay $79 of their rent. Then there's the ad valorem section. The taxes are based strictly on your assessed value.
Right.
The county always gets 1% under Prop 13. But those figures change from year to year. We're always, you know, putting little things in there all the time.
They can, that's, they can increase that by up to 2% a year.
Correct.
And then, but all these parcel taxes,
right, yes. Well, yeah, they're not ad valorem. They're just
so, you know, back again to Rohm Park and passing taxes. So let's say, you know, like CASA's finally come to fruition and Rohm Park, you know, puts it up, you know, like, you know, people are going to need to pay for building affordable or unaffordable housing. I don't think anyone can really get 55% of Rohm Park. And you see, I think it's stuck to the geography. I mean, again, I think this cause of the problem with it is like the nine counties of the Bay Area are not all created equally. So like maybe one county would say, yeah, I think out of, you know, the kindness of our heart, we're willing to give, the, you know, some money for affordable housing.
Let me just point out with, Measure AA, the $12 parcel tax that passed in June of 2016, it required supermajority. But the range, so it only required supermajority for the nine county region as a whole. And actually, it didn't pass in four counties. It didn't pass in Contra Costa, Solano, Marin. Or rather, Contra Costa, Solano, Napa, and Sonoma.
So this is going to be the same thing. So 55, if they pass the 55%, it's going to be in all nine counties. Is that what you're saying?
That's right. So even if it doesn't pass in Sonoma County, Sonoma County pays.
But what's it, so is it, does it have to be all nine counties?
Just add in totality, 55% of the voters.
Oh, I see.
In all nine counties as a whole.
Now I get it.
So even though some counties don't hit that margin, they still have.
So small rural towns are going to get I get it.
Okay, we've got some other questions.
So
I think one thing that underlies the risk in all of the legislation that's being proposed is that they're saying local authorities will no longer have any control over the development. So the governor is now behind it as well, holding not only the incentive, financial incentive, but also the stick. If you don't do this, you're going to be deprived of all kinds of funding. So that, you know, we've had some reasonably nice development in San Francisco, some of it that has gone ahead, but that's on the basis of our planners putting them through the paces to make sure it's going to be acceptable in terms of our own heights and our own, and making it evolve. Right now, what Scott Meter is doing is saying basically tower blocks forever and you can't stop it. If it's anywhere within reach of a transit hub, which in San Francisco is practically the whole city, you cannot say no. So basically, I think it's a recipe for saying, let market forces rip because we've got to build all these units. It doesn't matter even whether people live in them. You know that there's so many of the new tower blocks, a lot of them are empty because they're great investments for people from elsewhere, real estate in San Francisco, so that if this goes through, we'll lose the ability to stop that kind of development. I just wanted to point out, I remember from a long time ago, there was a great architect London, who wrote a book called Cities Aren't Good for Us, and he makes the case for social housing for density but against tower blocks. It is not necessary to have tower blocks to house a lot of people, and yet that's the impression that they give.
Well, Scott Weiner, if you says that too, they will say, well, we don't, even in R1 neighborhoods, we don't want tower blocks, we just want, you know, fourplexes and eightplexes, and if we did that everywhere, we could solve a big part of our housing problem. I guess you could, but at the rate that R1 properties turn over, it would take decades to do that. And he'll actually admit that if you pin him down. This will take 4 years.
But without the scrutiny of local authorities, the state doesn't care what it looks like or how it looks.
Right. Oh, yeah, there's, I know, there's a, well, if you go to
elsewhere, which is more
important.
Sure. So the fourplex, so if I make it one, so I have to stand up and just answer your question. Yeah, fourplex versus tower block. That was basically what I was trying to get at, that you don't have to, I mean, the fact is that this legislation is going to deregulate number of units. So you don't want to focus on the height. Focus on the number of units that are going to be built on tiny city lots. So one big difference between San Francisco and the suburban communities around, correct me if I'm wrong, Michael, is San Francisco doesn't have any floor area ratio. You guys probably do have it.
Okay.
We have no floor area ratio. Floor area ratio is the ratio of building to the lot. So if
that counts, it counts stories.
We have it in the form of zoning. Some zoning actually.
Right. We do, but then if they remove that, then we're screwed. But then if they remove that for the suburbs, because they do have a floor area ratio, they could still control that somewhat. So like if you have a lot in Albany, as an, I'm giving an example, that is 4,000 square feet, and your floor area ratio is 0.5, you could only build 2,000 square feet. Building on that. Well, how many apartments can you stick in 2,000 square feet? Not very many. So unless you actually take advantage of this height addition, incentives, blah, 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 it's not as possible as doing it in Albany as opposed to Bayview, as opposed to Excelsior, because we do not have any floor area ratio. So you could actually take 75% of the lot and, you know, basically build to the 40-foot height that is allowed.
Well, I'm higher, go to 60 feet.
And here's the funny thing. There is, in Wiener's bills, there's no, and the people at Transform pointed out, there's no minimum number of units required.
Exactly.
In other words, if this were to pass in Albany, a Russian oligarch could come in, buy up four of our little housing lots, a four-story McMansion there.
Right.
Two rooms with
exactly.
Two affordable units, one for the maid, one is for chauffeur.
Right.
And we have no zoning authority to stop that.
We have that in San Francisco.
Okay, are there a couple, any other questions?
I just had a thought.
Or a comment.
I've long thought that the base problem of what now people are calling a housing shortage is that our employment centers are privately decided. And so they move to where they want to move, but they don't move to areas that are empty, that are vacant, that have lots of stuff, and could easily create towns that have jobs and people could live near their towns. I read an interesting book by Farley Mowat called The Siberians. When they developed the Siberians, they had this terrible problem with permafrost, and whatever they built sank. And they had to figure it out. They figured it out. It took a long time. And they built communities in which they had all the amenities. Every community was limited to 50,000 people, so that the community could thrive and they could contain the problems of living in that kind of climate. Then they would build another one, and they would build it related to what economic engines they had in those areas, so that the housing and everything else was related to the engine. Here, if the Silicon developers, and basically the billionaire investors, want to do whatever they want to do, they do it, and the cities just fall over flat, and the officials do, they, yes, yes, of course, and there's no housing, there's no infrastructure.
Not only Cupertino's.
So they put the jobs where there isn't enough to support that, and then we
move jobs where the people are.
Exactly.
And that would be the easy pay, like Walnut Creek. Why are they all, why do people have to commute? Why can't we put a job in East Bay? And sometimes that happens, for example, BioRad has moved out to Pleasanton. BioRad's a big.
Well, some companies have moved to Sparks and Reno.
Well, yeah, Charles Schwab moved to Phoenix.
Local government controls by Cupertino keeps delaying building housing in Valcom.
Yeah, the Valcom.
Like, it's an empty mall. They should build 30 stories there. It's
well,
local control.
If you have companies like Google and Facebook and Apple that are building on 100-acre campuses that are just offices, they must build housing, and they're going to bring in 30,000 workers.
Yeah.
They got to build housing.
But their local government doesn't let them.
No.
That's the point. They should be forced to.
They should be forced to, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's that jobs housing balance.
Balance.
Right.
That you're talking about.
It's funny. That's when I was at the SBA 27 hearing last year. As people left after the bill was defeated, that's exactly what was on everybody's lips, was jobs housing balance. But you know, Google is building, it's working on a housing complex in San Jose. So near that area they call the Digger on area. But still, I noticed in the paper last week, Facebook is building a complex with 1,500 homes in it. However, it's got 8,000 spaces for workers, so they're only 6,500 in the whole. There's another complex going in that will house 9,000 workers. Now, there's no place for people to live.
Google is building something here.
Okay. Sorry, I cut.
Yeah.
Stepped on your toe there. Let's thank Michael, and then I have two quick things. First thing is, this month, the Coalition for Complete Community Interim Use at the old McDonald's site is going to be meeting with the mayor and turning in the RFP for a proposal for community uses and youth services on that site. And you can help us by signing that you'd like to support that project or sending emails to the Mayor London Breed at sf.gov and to our supervisor. And we will have a more clear proposal by the end of the month when we have to turn it in. But you've probably seen the draft one by now. And then secondly,
just before you leave that, so there's an appointment set up with the mayor?
Yes, we have an appointment with Sean Elsbrin, London's chief of staff. On the 23rd, I think. So the second thing is that we're planning to do a meeting on the subject of 420. And so if you have any questions you'd like answered in that meeting, it suggests that you...
What's 420, by the way, please?
This is a test. How many of you know what 420 is?
We smoke pot or something.
Yeah. Okay. In our next meeting, please tell Alex, who's in the back of the room with the wonderful hat, and that we'll have a forum on that next month about what's going to be happening and the new rules from the city and so forth.
What happened to the dispensary today?
I believe it was approved.
The way we advertise our city properly is important, and I would ask this board to ask that they go off and come back with other recommendations. Thank you.
No other speakers on that. Thank you. The vote of the roll. Vote of the roll. Tabulate the vote.
12 ayes.
12 ayes. Donna's board person, name?
Yeah, 1119, coming. Morrisville.
Congratulations.
Anyway, our costs are great. I want to applaud our clients, and I don't feel that the race is entirely proper for our costs. Anyway, the valley is staying silent. We can't speak. We need to be open to Van Nuys video conferencing now. If you really care about the ballot, when you leave us in Spain, friends.
Of the council members that were present, we just had a unanimous vote to support the ordinance to ban alcohol ads on all city-owned and controlled property. Very significant victory because it's going to protect our children in the future from overexposure to alcohol advertising. They're the ones that tend to use the bus more frequently or go in areas where they get exposed to the advertising. So we hope it's a first step. You know, there's more work to be done, but it's a first step in trying to stop the industry from their advertising. You know, we're up against a whole lot of money.
Yeah, and you're saying it's a first step. To me, as they voted, it seemed like that's it. It's going to be done. Or you're saying it's a first step. Can you explain what's going to happen in the future regarding this process?
Well, there's other areas that were exempted from the ordinance, such as LAX and the stadium, if it gets built on city property. Those panels we're going to have to take up individually when it comes up in their commissions, and hopefully we can get them to ban alcohol ads in those specific sectors that are not covered by this ordinance.
I appreciate it. Thank you. Did you speak to me? Were you part of the group? Were you part of the group? Could you introduce yourself and just why you're doing what's important?
Susan can do it.
Please, Susan, if you would, introduce yourself, your group, why you're part of the coalition, what happened to you, any reflections?
Hi, I'm Susan Blonner, Director of Operations. Wait, hold on one second.
Ladies and gentlemen,
could I?
I understand that you work with the city regularly. A lot of you folks, I recognize the faces. Let me just inform you of some of the things that need to happen for future, not only for today, but for future when you come back to work with the city on other issues. The only people allowed back here are council members to conduct.
Should we start again?
Please, if you would. Again, introduce yourself, your group that you're with, that's part of the coalition. I'm going to step back a little bit. Okay. Introduce yourself. What happened to them? What's next?
Hi, my name is Susan Blonner. I'm the Director of Operations for Saving Lives Drug and Alcohol Coalition. And I'm here today in support of the ordinance to not have alcohol ads on public-owned property or city-owned property. And it is very important to have this so that our youth are not exposed to alcohol ads on the street. Thank you.
Now, is this the final step of the coalition? Does the coalition end today with this decision from City Hall?
That would be... That's definitely a question for Jorge, and no, we will continue on with our work to make sure that there is...